All right, so welcome to January, welcome to the jug. And what we do every month is just take a quick pass around the room, say hi, what we're interested in, why we're here. All right, so just a few housekeeping things. We've got a mailing list, which we sometimes post to still. We've got a meetup that we always post to and a Google Plus community that we never post to. So choose one of those channels. The meetup's probably the most effective one. We post videos of all the meetings where we don't lose the equipment or the data at tjug.ca/videos. And if you're interested in Java job postings, we have a extremely filtered mailing list at tjug.ca. Dan and I delete about 99 out of 100 posts to go there. Like, for example, today, if you wanted to be a QA engineer in Atlanta with no relocation offered, we didn't post that to that list. There's three things. It's Toronto, Java, jobs. And if it hits all three of those things, we post it. It's 99 out of 100, no. So.
That's a good conversion
rate. Yeah, it's amazing. So O'Reilly has offered discounts to all jugs, including ours. So you can use the top secret code PCBW to get 40% off print books or half off ebooks. Right, yeah, because nobody knows this code except everyone. So don't pay full price for those books. All right, there was some news. I guess probably most people saw this. If you've been here long enough to remember Mike Brock, this was his biggest pet peeve, that applets were still a thing. So now they're officially being deprecated in Java 9. So they'll still exist in Java 9, but they are now scheduled for removal in a future JDK, hopefully 10. Yeah. So that link at the bottom there has information about how to migrate to WebStart if that's your thing, but you could also just not use applets. So that happened. Another big piece of news: Android has moved over to use the library in OpenJDK. So all the Java SE types from OpenJDK's library replaced the ones that they were using from Harmony, which that project stopped in 2011 when Apache had a giant falling out with the JCP. So we expect this means a future release of Android OS will actually support Java 8 streams fully, which would be amazing. And we might even see Google contributing to the OpenJDK community eventually. Could happen. They might even come back to Java 1 one day. That'd be neat. So JDK 9 release schedule has the GA date for March 2017, so it's not too far off. It's further off than it was going to be. It was going to be September this year, but now it's March next year. But, Jigsaw's only been like 7 years in the making, so just need a few more months. But you can download early access builds now, and Jigsaw's in there, so do that. There's lots of people checking neat stuff. Like someone on Twitter was seeing what was the smallest JDK profile they could run Jython on, and it turned out you only need like 28 megabytes worth of JDK to run Jython, so that's pretty neat. So this eye chart is the list of JEPs that are targeted for JDK 9 so far. So there's actually a lot of really cool stuff coming.
React streams, maybe?
Yeah. That was one. Yeah, that should be in there.
Nice.
There was the HTTP 2 client. That's one of the oldest ones. It's going to come in. That's good.
They have like HTTP client, but they have like WebSockets in Java C.
Yeah.
WebSockets client.
The WebSockets client.
It's not there.
I fear that might be EE.
Yeah, it's in EE, but you know,
yeah.
Basically can use it in C and without any without anything any problems.
That's cool. And the other, what was the other neat one? There was a good one. The REPL. 222. So we can be the cool kids and just have a REPL with the JDK, and you can type in Java statements and have the result print out. So that's kind of neat. 262, TIFF image IO. It's like 15 years ago, that would have been.
How about CMYK JPEG?
You don't see that one. No. No, you can't have that. Yeah.
There should be like GIF support.
Yeah.
Like animated GIFs. It's a new thing right now.
Oh, they're going to expose the parser API for Nashorn. So if you were wondering if JavaScript has a grammar, I guess it does, and now there's an API for it too.
Is it really?
I don't know. Some XML features still trickling in too, XML catalogs. So lots of stuff. It's not just Jigsaw. There's a bug that was opened in the past month. Somebody's finally complained in an official way that when you jar and unjar files, you lose all the file permission bits. So if you want to be able to put executable scripts into your jars, for example, if you're extracting jars inside Docker, and you don't have unzip in your Docker image, maybe jar could do that for you one day. So you can vote for that. It has one vote right now. So get going. No, it was the guy who posted it. Okay, this was a blog post from
Alexi.
So the question is, are you better off using collections? There should be an S. No, it's not S. Collection.toArray, and just pass in a zero-size array, which means that the library is supposed to allocate the array for you to put all of the elements into. Or should you specify the target size? The idea being, the reason that the second variant was ever put there is because the first one just tells the library what type you want, and then it has to figure out how big to make the array. And the second one is you're giving it an array and saying, dump the collection in here, and if it's too small, just throw an exception. So it's a very interesting, very long article. To invest a couple of hours in reading it, but the spoiler is that at the end, it looks like actually the easier one, where you just pass in an empty array, is actually faster. Contractually cleaner, as in if you don't know if the collection might actually be changing size, you could fail if you call like collection.getSize or collection.size and it might get bigger and then you'll fail. So that's taken care of by the zero size variant. And so it's faster and cleaner, and you should probably just use that one. So that's pretty cool. But interesting to see how he got there. And then this also came up. It's not really Java specific, but it's interesting. I've thought about this kind of stuff in the past. It's just like kind of like an XKCD style chart of how long things take.
I saw one of these at one point where they compared it to like human time. So they said like one clock cycle was like 1 second, and then they did all of these, and the longer ones ended up being like 10 years.
Yeah. Some of them you could like, you might as well store the data on Mars and like send an expedition to go get it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's in the basement.
Yeah.
It's on the moon.
Exactly. So, interesting to think about. And some of the trade-offs are surprising, like reading a megabyte sequentially from SSD, about a millisecond, but sending, where is it? There was sending a, oh, it was only, see, they were kind of cheating there. Sending a kilobyte across a gigabit network, 10 microseconds. So anyway. Interesting stuff. The trade-offs aren't always obvious. But SSD is better. So I probably miss stuff, usually do. Especially because we didn't meet last month, so we got 2 months worth of happenings.
Oh yeah, so in early March is J-Days in Sweden. Is anyone going to that? It's a pretty awesome Java conference. Because I'm going.
You going? Awesome.
Because Java conference is the place to do that.
Was that used to be called JFocus, or is it a different conference?
No idea.
Okay. I think it might be. It's the right time of year for JFocus.
Yeah, I think it's renamed
to JFocus. Oh, cool. I've always wanted to go there. So have fun and tell me what I'm missing.
Yeah, maybe I'll do a talk about, what's up.
Do that, for sure. And more talks about Java game development would also be amazing.
Yeah, you have to play my new game.
I will. Okay. So, anything else before I hand it over to Victor? No? Okay. Enjoy.
Okay, so I hope this 45 minutes of your life gonna be entertaining enough and informative enough. We're gonna talk about distributed caching. So, question, what is this? This is easy one, right? This is NoSQL key value in memory storage, also known as hash map, right? So who can spot some of the problems if you try to run this in distributed, and in multi-threaded environment?
Synchronization, et cetera.
Yeah, we can fix it, right? But how you can do this with if you want to run it not multi-threaded, but multi-process environment? Boom. So as you can see, I'm just changing one line and changing dramatically how the application behaves. However, some of the things stays the same. For example, the API for accessing this map. And we're going to talk about this stuff and other stuff today. So let's start with some fancy demo, I guess. Usually, fancy demos contains the console. So and in this, don't pay attention, it says enterprise. It just what I downloaded on the plane here. Actually, it was an airport. So what I'm doing this right now, so I have a the command line application that allows me to do something to the Hazelcast cluster. And as you can see, I have two members of Hazelcast cluster, and I can do some of the fancy operations. For example, I run the help. And from the help, I see there's certain operations that I can do on map. So what I would do, I will do map.put from one place, key, Toronto, jug. And I'll do read from here. I'll do map.get and by key one. Isn't it exciting? It's two processes. You know, I write in one and I read another one. Yeah? How cool is that? So what about doing something to prevent to doing this? So I do m.lock. And here I'm trying to do m.put one, say, New York Java SIG. And I cannot do anything here, right? Because this guy prevented me to write this. So in this case, I do unlock. And after that, I can write here. So as you can see here, it returns the previous value. Obviously, this is the semantic that we have from Java map. When you do map.put, you have the returning value with previous value. Another cool stuff, let's run help once again. And what you can see here, there is some of the messaging stuff. And I can actually do cool.offer Toronto jug. And what I can do here, I can do cool.pull. Oops, sorry, wrong window. Q.offer once again. So you didn't see this before. Toronto jug. And I read it in another one. So I do Q.pull. Voila. So we have not only the map as our medium, but also we have a queue is to interchange the data between our processes. So as I remember, we did map.put something into this map. I'll do map.get one to remind you that we have New York Java SIG here. And what happens if this node will die? Can I still read this from here? Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Still, I have a result here. It's some additional output of the Hazelcast. Let me show you once again, m.get1, still there. Let me bring this guy back. This is a bunch of nonsense that you see right now. I'm going to explain. So it's just supposed to be cool because multiple text stuff is running on the screen. So yeah. After demo, I will introduce myself because usually, like, people, I reading like these books about like presenting and stuff, and people saying like, just, you know, spend 5 minutes to important stuff. Already done, so you can like enjoy yourself, drink beer. I'm gonna just create some fancy noise here, and I'm gonna introduce myself. I'm tweet at the this JMUSSA. I'm a solutions architect with Hazelcast. I'll do speaking on the conferences. And I wrote the book about enterprise web development. This is how I envisioned solution architect's job. This is how I envisioned speaking at the conferences. And this is how my book looks like. So after I wrote this enterprise web development, I decided to switch to enterprise distributed computing and distributed stuff. And we're going to talk about things that Hazelcast provides. But I want to do like a couple phrases that includes. Okay, do we have this like a bullshit bingo sheets here? Like, we have distributed, highly available, scalable, open source, data grid, in memory. So next time I probably need to bring this so people can, hey, bullshit bingo. But it's not bullshit, it's real deal. So Hazelcast is actually open source. We Apache V2 license from the day one. And it's in memory. So we're not touching any disks. Everything handled by in memory of the Java process and the fancy network stuff that we also introduced in the product. And because of the some of the things that we have in mind from day one, like scalability and like simplicity and high availability, some of the things that I already show, you see I have two processes running. I wrote the data on one, wrote another one. That process died, but my data is still there. So how cool is that? Still highly available. So in usually, like when I'm talking about Hazelcast, and today I'm going to talk about more like a collection piece, like because it's already well known for developers. Like, how many of you know Java till now? How many of you know Java util concurrent package? That's cool, because sometimes people don't really know this, even though it was like more 10 years since it was introduced. How many of you know like Java blogging queue and all this stuff, right? So this is actually fits into description of in-memory storage. This is MAP, in-memory computing, executor service, different atomics from Java util concurrent, and messaging that based on the Java Java blocking queue. Demo. So let's do something more fancy, right? I'll kill these guys, and we'll do some real enterprise stuff, like with high availability, scalability. Where is my window? All right. So what I have here on my screen, so I'll start a couple notes of Hazelcast cluster. Let's start with three, because we know that real distributed system starts with the odd number. Node failed to start. This is kind of fun. Let me try again. Actually, it's knife. It's live debugging. Let's see. Let's see if we can spot the problem. What happens here? Probably I'm running out of memory or something like that. No. How? It's not active. That's crazy. That's not the case, I guess. Let me check a little quick. Where is it? License. Yeah, this is what happens like when you download like enterprise. I need to download the open source piece. in this case, it would be much. No, license should be somewhere here. Yeah, that's here. So that should be fine. Probably I have something else running, kill Java. No, it's wrong one. Okay, I don't want to kill it. Okay, let me start once again, maybe. Boop. Magic. Okay. It's crazy. I don't know what's happening. Fail to start. Yet this is kind of. Okay. So let's do local stuff. Okay. Probably I know. Sometimes it's the. The system is more smarter than me. Yeah. Okay. And screw this. This stuff doesn't work. Okay. So I don't. Open source. Some of the people actually like made it work, and they actually include it in their products. So we're part of the Vertex. If you heard about this, it's a nice framework if you're writing application in different languages, and the Vertex using us to do HA. They sort of like redistributed the verticals. I don't have it on this slide, but there's a company called Poyara that they provide the commercial open source support for Glassfish, and Poyara uses the Hazelcast for clustering, and some other folks. So that's very important, but when it works, in this case it doesn't, so it may be not that important. But the most important thing that I'm going to talk to you about today is the programming model. So I will show you some of the examples of the code, and you will see that this kind of thing is actually easy to set up, easy to use, again, when it's work. Some of the things that this is why, like, some of the developers and open source community, they choose us for their product is that because the ease of programming model. So let's see some code in this case. I'm still interested. Why it's broken? Okay, so let's can you see the code well? Yeah, so let's return to this example that I started in the very beginning. So let me run it. Hopefully, because this is open source part, it should work. Nope. I think it's something with the network here. Can assign address. I guess it's something wrong with the. Usually, like disabling Wi-Fi works. Let me try it. Enable once again. It's clearly clearly some of the problem with network.
Does the server usually like check for open ports?
No, it's not problem with the port. So we have we have this like known problem that people start the process. Oh, port is busy. So we actually can probe the port and increment it automatically. So that's not the case. I guess it's something with the way how the network works. So I'll start explaining once if it doesn't, you know, it's called dog debugging. So if I don't know what's happening, I usually have like a dog on my desktop and I start explaining things to dog. So I'm going to do like live dog debugging for you, and I probably will come up with some idea why it doesn't work. So basically what happens here right now, when I invoke this call, it essentially creates the instance of Hazelcast member. If I run it like twice, it will create another member within the same JVM, and they would use the same configuration to connect to each other. However, as you can see here, I didn't provide any configuration file for this guy. So in this case, it uses default that we ship with the Hazelcast. By default, that configuration defined in this class or in this file, we're using multicast for node discovery. So probably multicast failing at some point. Let's try again. We will try until it will work. Sweet. Now, so I believe there was a problem with some of the multicast in this network. As you can see, like in the output, we always can see like obviously version. We can see what's the network stack going to be used, like V6 or V4, and the most important part you want to see in your the Hazelcast application is this, is members. This thing allow you to see how many members you have in the cluster. And the call on line 9 successfully executed, instance created. It will accept network connections. I will start another member, and we'll see how it join and ruin this data once again. I'm just putting something into the map called map. That's very very good name for map. And after that, I'm printing the loading is done. And as you can see, I'm still running. So in this case, the thread is not the explicitly leaving this, and process still running. So you don't need to do anything like user input and stuff. And I have another member. So what it does, it also creates Hazelcast instance, and it also accessing the same map. And after that, it will iterate over the elements of this map. So when I run this, we will see a couple things. Hopefully. Remember when I said this is most important line? In this line, you see now where output of my particular node. And for that purpose, we have this. This is me. This is it's my output. And this is guy who just joined. So he joined, and after that, he iterated over entry set of this map. As you can see, there is no proprietary API, so to speak. It's just a no Hazelcast thing. It's just a Java util map. And the reason for that is that this method returns IMAP, which is essentially extends concurrent map, which is extends map. So in the same way as you can see in here, you can do concurrent hash map. It will work. Obviously, we need to cast it, I guess, now. Concurrent map. I'm sorry. Concurrent hash map. It's implementation. We extending the interface concurrent map, and also I can do the IMAP, which is already Hazelcast API. So who knows, like, what's the difference between map interface and the concurrent map? Like, what this interface brings here? Yeah, so there's a couple methods that was introduced. Exactly, putif absent. However, they changed this thing in Java 8, and now just Java map has putif absent out of the box, as far as I understand. If it's yeah, you see? So now the map interface, so basically they same. They just have this hierarchy for compatibility. Exactly, yeah. Yeah, this is because of default map. All right, so Any questions about this particular example? So now I would like to try to run my demo once again. Who with me? I believe the network was dependent on some weather, and I'll try to run it. Okay, first one. Okay, first go. Let's do. Fingers crossed. That's. So what I can do in this case. So again?
I saw the management center service could not be constructed or something just there. I'm not sure.
Interesting. Let's check the config. So this is actually good time for checking the config for how this Hazelcast configuration looks like. So remember when I said like if there is no explicit configuration for Hazelcast, there would be a default configuration be taken. But I also can supply with the Hazelcast XML in if the Hazelcast XML would be available in the class path. So in this case, this configuration will be taken into account. So I think one of the problems that causing me this issue is that I have the explicitly enabled TCP. So I will disable it and enable back to multicast because we already saw that multicast actually works here. So I'll switch you back to multicast. And this is actually the join section defines the network configuration. By default, as I said, we use multicast for discovery. Once we discover the node, we switch to TCP connection. But if you don't have the reliable multicast or don't want to use like this auto discovery thing, you can actually provide the list of members. Also, we support a bunch of different clouds, and as you know, many clouds doesn't allow you to do multicast there. And to discover other nodes, you need to know their API. So this is exactly what we're doing, for example, in this AWS section, where we need to provide the key and the secret to do discovery within AWS. With the recent release of 3.6, we actually introduced a generic way, so you can actually plug your own implementation. And we see some of the community folks, they contributed with the console discovery, SkyDNS discovery. The guy from Google, he helped us to bring the Kubernetes discovery. This is actually cool stuff. So you can actually define the tag that you can tag your Hazelcast instances. In terms of like access, we just need to be able to connect your AWS account and query machines that you have or on. We need to know like in what region we want to take the query. We want to know like if you have like specific security group for Hazelcast members, and you can tag particular the AWS machines. We're also taking into account. Yeah, and we'll see like it creates the member list, and after that tries to connect to these members. Okay, so third time. Okay. This is something that never happens with me before.
Just try the third one, just for fun.
It's good stuff. I see we have the engineers here. Yeah. I don't know, like, this is some crazy stuff. Enterprise license cannot be found.
This license is not available in your network.
actually, this is ridiculous. This is, I don't know, like, this is, it looks like, right. I can validate license by just looking into this one, and this, like, looks pretty legit. I don't know. I don't know. No, it's a 3.6 license. Should be fine. That's crazy. Let's see. Maybe it's a different what kind of file? Hazelcast XML's working directory. Yeah, that should be fine. And the discover node connect node could not be from check not doing shutdown now. Okay, yeah, that's kind of fun. Yeah. I don't know. Like,
at least there's a clear explanation. So.
That sounds. It's not supposed to happen. I don't want to, like, next time I never like download enterprise thing. Okay, see, where's the license? Yay, I have this unlimited license. Let's try it once again. Wait, I don't know, like something weird happened, so I have like, anyways, just, I don't want to waste the time. So, couple more things. I will run this demo, so don't worry. It's gonna be there. So, in terms of accessing for Hazelcast the cluster, we can be embedded. So this is most popular the use case that we see that other people embedded Hazelcast to do the clustering on their application. And in our approach, like when you need to sort of segregate your service, like your, for example, API service or some HTTP server from the actual storage, we support a client server mode. So, and the difference, it's actually, there's no difference in terms of, where is it? I'll show you some of the code. There's no difference in terms of API. And clients, basic. So this is like, I'll just start the member here, and the member in this case will just listen the queue, and will constantly. No, come on, it's open source. There shouldn't be no license. It's ridiculous. It's killing me. This is something wrong. So this is terrible. This is terrible. All right. So in this case, I'm starting the member, and as you can see, when I created the instance of the member, I'm retrieving Hazelcast instance the interface. So, and when I'm creating the client, I also creating Hazelcast client instance, but the result is Hazelcast instance. So reason for that, you can actually, if you're writing something for that will work with Hazelcast, you can actually use any topology, right? You can, you know, locally program using embedded mode, and after that you deploy and instantiate the client, or you know, you have a different Spring configuration files when you know you instantiate and be in Hazelcast instance using the client factory. Yeah, just a moment. And you have another bin that instantiated Hazelcast member using the Hazelcast.new Hazelcast instance. Yes.
Well, is there a reason why all your queues and maps are strings?
Say again.
Why all the queues and maps are creating the
String.
Blocking queue of string cannot be blocking queue of.
Yes. It's nothing to do with Hazelcast. It's just a generic. It can be, you know, it's the generics. It's just compile time. It's just compile time check. It can be, and it still will work in, right. It's just a compile time check. It can be your map can be a map of integer strings or map of objects, map of anything else.
So, for example, I could have a map of string to database connection. What's going to happen? Because it's not reasonable to expect that that type of object would be able to transfer from one system to another or one process to another.
Oh, can you repeat the question?
So, if I had a map of string to database connection.
Is it serializable?
Well, that's my point. So there is a restriction that it must be a
This is good question. Yes. So, obviously, because... Not obviously, okay, so I will explain. So when we do things like, I'm gonna talk about field member. So every time when we do map.put, this operation actually does interesting thing. So we're taking this key, we serialize this key, after that we apply a hash function, and after that, we can actually calculating the partition ID. So the partition is the basically storage of the data. So when you're inserting data into Hazelcast, it will be stored inside the partition. Also, partition is the part of the migration. Migration is the process that happens when new node joins the Hazelcast cluster or the one node is leaves. So we need to reshuffle the partition across the available nodes in a way that we have pretty much the even distribution of partitions across the cluster. So in this case, we sort of architecturally cannot have more saturated node or less saturated node. So where were I? Okay, so we actually calculated partition ID. And after that, we also serialized the value and inserting this value into this partition. So inside the Hazelcast, the value can be stored in binary format. So it will be, once it arrives on this node, it will be stored as a byte stream, or it can be stored as an object. So it will be deserialized on the other side, and a new object will be created. So there is a different reasons for that. One of the reasons that we have some APIs that can benefit from having the object on the other side, instead of doing the deserialization each and every time when we hitting this object. For example, our query API or our entry processor API works faster because there's no additional deserialization step. For that reason, the value always needs to be serializable. Java serializable works in, I don't know, like 70% of cases. However, it's not the best thing that we have. I haven't seen this in the JAP. We still have a serialization 2.0 there. In your slide, do you remember? So,
I didn't see that one.
Yeah, the Java serialization, yeah, that would be actually sad. Yeah, so the Java serialization, it's not the best thing that we have. And if you ever seen the any like Java puzzlers from George's blog, you know that there's lots of nasty stuff might happen, including like when you're serializing some the anonymous classes and stuff like that. So for and again, object size is there.
It's amazing until your representation changes.
Exactly. And for that purpose, we also support, to make it better, to make it more performant, we actually, as a Hazelcast API, we provide a bunch of our own serialization. And you can plug your own protocol buffers, Cryo, Thrift, whatever you want. You can plug it, and it can be used with Hazelcast. But yes. If you have like ability to do byte to object to byte, or if you have ability to, like stream to object, so yeah, you can plug anything. I played around with the Bison the library that the MongoDB guys provide, that they use in the MongoDB driver. Not super performant in queries, but you still can, you know, store some binary JSON in Hazelcast using their library. This is a question about serialization. A couple things about our own serialization format. We have a serialization format that allows to interact. Remember in my slide, in this slide, I also have Java API, C++ API, and .NET API. So we have this client that can interact with the Hazelcast Java server, but for a reason, you know, you have a different object representation in .NET or C++, we need to provide some of the common serialization. So we have this format called portable that doesn't rely on like Java class because it has embedded the class definition. And we provide the portable API on C#, C++, and Java. So you can write your object in Java and read it on C# and vice versa. And even more interesting that we have one of the clients, they actually .NET shop. And there's just only one guy who knows Java, and he's responsible for like the Hazelcast magic. Rest of the guys, they just, you know, writing this .NET ASP.NET application and reading, writing data. And it actually works pretty well. Our .NET client on Nugget, you can you know, grab it from there. If you need this, I don't know, for some maybe you, So yeah, I want to talk a little bit about data distribution and how it works in Hazelcast and why we can say without touching the disk we can still preserve your data. So there's two types of data distribution: the replication and partitioning or sharding. So what's the difference? Replication, we have total copy. So you saw this in many products in the market, like when you do like master-slave replication. You actually creating the copy of the data. And for obvious reason, replication is not scale well because you cannot like scale horizontally. You need to scale up to get like a bigger and bigger machine to fit all your data. And for that reason, people using to scale horizontally, people using partitioning. So partitioning is actually splitting. So we're taking these guys and splitting them. Sorry, it's I think it's like terrible the picture, but you got the point, right? It's like you have the mental model, like it's replication. This let's go next. So what we do with Hazelcast by default, the model that how it works, it's partitioned. So everything starts with 271 partition. 271 partition, this is number of default partition. As I already explained to you a little bit, you have, when you're putting something into the Hazelcast, we serialize the key and apply a hash function and do mod by 271 to get a particular partition ID. And after that, the data goes into this partition. So this is how it looks like in OneNote. And it's very similar to concurrent hash map, for example, right? There's also some of the buckets inside the hash map that can be accessed by only one thread at a time. Pretty much same thing, but in distributed world. Now, what happens when we're adding more node? So by default, the Hazelcast create one of the backup of the partitions that's stored on primary node. So what you can see on the top, like on this part, is primary partitions. You saw them here. This is primary partition. There's no backups because obviously we cannot store the backup on the same node because that doesn't make any sense. If we lose this node, we lose everything anyways. So in this case, when we add more node, we now can do a little bit of the partition migration or reshuffling. And we have, as you can see, we have the backup of primary nodes, of primary partitions stored on node 2. And if this node goes down, these backups will be promoted into the primary nodes, and you will see the same picture. So, and actually, it scales very well. in terms of getting the equal distribution of partition across across the cluster. Now, you can it's very simple picture that explains how the thing works. You actually might have up to 6 backups. So in cluster of 7 nodes, you can have up to 6 copies of your data. I think it's pretty enough in terms of saving the data. And in terms of the control of how this the backup distributed or the how this all stuff is going on, by default it's quite random. So you don't really know how the backup on what node this the particular backup will end up. So there is some certain control. You can actually group your members, your Hazelcast nodes into the partition groups. So in this case, the backup of the data will not going to end up on the same group. So it's sometimes I see the people they run in Hazelcast like 2 instances of Hazelcast on one machine, and they have like 2 total machines, and they don't want to lose the data if your the physical machine goes down. So in this case, they have this so-called host-aware partition group, and Hazelcast smart enough to know, okay, looks like we're running the multiple nodes in one host. So I'm not going to put the backups on this host. I want to put it on the another host. This is any question about this distributed structure? Yeah.
Do I have any way to control where particular pieces of data end up within those buckets? So for example, if I'm trying to distribute work so that I know ahead of time that certain values are going to be more work than others. Can I push those to be distributed differently?
No.
Okay.
I'll explain why.
Sure.
So there is basically 2 mental models of surviving in distributed systems, right? You can tolerate failures, or you can try to avoid this. So you cannot avoid this. In this case, there's only one thing. You need to tolerate failures. And the way how we design the Hazelcast and the way how it's designed is to way how we can tolerate failures, because failure is going to happen. And we better know how to manage data. And we better know how we can preserve your data and how we can handle your data in case of failures. So this is why giving you control. So you cannot have like a stickiness, right? Because it will break some of the consistent hash algorithms. It breaks some of the fundamentals. It breaks some of the consistency guarantee that we have in our API. And this is why we don't have a control. However, you have control to collocate related data. So for example, you have a company, you have associate, they also have the company ID. You want to able to look up the company map inside the associate you have a company ID, and you want to look up this map by company ID. So in this case, you can have the company ID as the partition aware key. So in this case, data with associate with the same company ID and the company ID, they will end up on the same partition. So this lookup will not gonna go over network. So this is kind of collocation you can get. In terms of, I'm just talking about more like storage use case, but if we bring some of the distributed computing in this place, so what's gonna happen is, I'm usually telling the people that it's not usual model. Like when we do some computation, we need to go there somewhere. We need to bring some data. We do some computation, put in somewhere. So in Hazelcast, we have different mental model. Instead of bringing the data back to the client, because this data can be huge, because your cluster can be like hundreds of nodes and you have a terabytes of data. Instead of bringing this data to poor little client to do computation, we can actually send the computation there. So this is just in the form Java runnable or just executor service. You have executor service submit to all members. And your Java runnable actually will be able to get access only like only local data. So in this case, you don't need to do additional calls when you're running some distributed computation because of the reason that I just said, data would be super big. I forgot to mention that I have a t-shirts here. There's awesome t-shirts, and I will give them for people with like a question. So do not forget to ask questions. And let me show you actually some code of this kind of behavior that I just described. So distributed executor. So let me actually show you task. So this is actually, this is how your distributed task can look like. It's just a simple Java runnable. This runnable needs to be serializable because this runnable also, when you submit it to the executor service, it also be the sent to the cluster. And there is also like a magic interface that Hazelcast will recognize when this payload of your Java runnable will arrive on the Hazelcast cluster. So when it will be deserialized on the other side, Hazelcast will inject particular instance of this member. So using this approach, you can get access only to local data. So your runnable task that will be executed will be accessing only local data. There will be no network call. It's pretty nice. It is like, I don't know, maybe it's like a MapReduce. But your data was already mapped, and you just need to do like reduce stuff. And from the perspective how to invoke this, it's actually fairly simple. From the Hazelcast instance, we can get access to executor service by name, and in this case, we can execute only like on the key owner. So this is like specific example that like takes all key. By the way, never do this operation in production because like a key set can be huge, right? There is another approach how to do this is you can get like specific member. So you can get from the API, also you can get the members, and you can execute this task on particular, in this case, like it still executes on all members. But the idea is to, you know, there's a way how you can be, say, okay, I want to send this task there, I want to send this task there, I want to send this task there. You might ask, okay, so, but what if I just want to have the compute grid. So I don't want to bring any data, right? I just don't want to have any maps. I just want to do some computation. For example, I'm writing some distributed network crawler, right? So for that purpose, we introduced the thing called light member. The task is, you know, it's nothing special here. This doing some of the computation. It's callable, serializable, Hazelcast instance aware. And where is it, light member? So it's just a matter of configuration. You can say it's a light member. In this case, Hazelcast would know that we're not gonna put these partitions into this member. So this member will not have any data, but it will still will be in cluster. It will still be the part of the cluster topology. It's actually like very very nice. And how to execute this? You already seen this executor.submit or executor.execute. The same API that's similar API, I would say, to Java util concurrent. I want to show you one more API that we have. It's called execution callback. Sometimes when you're running the, sometimes if you're running this very intensive the operation, you need to, you know, you don't want to holding this the future that you'll get from executor service. You probably want to get notified when it's done. So in this case, we have this interface called the execution callback, and you can define the logic that needs to be invoked after this task would be executed, right? This was kind of our workaround until we have the completable future. And we actually wrote our own completable future implementation because we our clients, they rely on Java 6, Java 7, Java 8. We cannot force everyone to move Java 8. I would love to because it allows us to do awesome stuff. Probably in the Hazelcast 4, we will, you know, Java 8 will be baseline. And yeah, but, you know, unfortunately, like, this is like not gonna happen like maybe this year, maybe next year. We can like introduce the distributed streams and stuff. For example, here, this guy can return, we have it called iCompletable. This is our guy. This is a kind of thing that we implemented to have similar the behavior of completable future. And if you're running on Java 8, I think you can cast this to, you know, this future can cast it to completable future. It should be fine. There's different different ways how to you know, control the task. How much time do I have?
What time is it?
Oh, shit.
I didn't make
counting. yeah, sorry for broken demo, but still, I think it's, you know, I was asking the customs today, like, what's the reason of your, you know, of your visit? I said, you know, like, we, like, programmers, we like to write the code and on the work, and after work, we want to go to talk other programmers about the code. So this is what I do. I'm going to go to write to talk about the code with other programmers. Couple things that you probably want to learn from this code samples. We have very nice repository. It's open. It's GitHub. Obviously, who's not on GitHub today? And that's called Hazelcast code samples. Everything that I'm talking or you see, everything that Hazelcast can do, everything is there. Like when I talk to people saying, "Hey, can you integrate? How you can integrate with MongoDB, for example?" I say, well, so I can do Hazelcast integration and do MongoDB, right? And I have some examples here that does load from MongoDB to Hazelcast. Or you can say, oh, how it can work with Spring Boot, for example? Well, I have it here. Where is it? Yeah. I have this Spring Boot application that does the thing and many, many other things. This is a very nice project, and you should definitely check this out. Each and every example done in a way that is just a public static void main Java, the Java class. So you can actually like take it from there, and you don't need to just one dependency that you need. We also have this hazelcast.org. This is like, where do I start? Just go here. Copy this code and start, you know, your experiments. Multiple things that I didn't mention yet. So one of the nice features that we have, it's called entry processor. So another tool that allow you to change your mental the mental representation, how you need to do safe modification of data instead of getting data from distributed system, do local modification, put it back. Multiple things might happen during this. So we have this the entry processor that actually will be sent to the grid, sent to this data, where this data is, and atomically will do some modification. So this is exactly what happens here. The reason why this kind of stuff is guaranteed is that the entry processor will be executed on the same thread that, like, it's called partition thread that manage this, like, the partition the same way as you have it on concurrent hash map, but in distributed way. And very cool stuff. If you guys know the ring buffer or it got like a little traction when the LMAX, the open source this disruptor framework. We also have Rune Buffer. Yay, it's our own implementation, and it's distributed. It's even cooler. It actually gives you very nice and very fast performance in terms of messaging, because the Ring Buffer is essentially not growing, right? You, when it's created, you define the size, and after that, you just, you know, moving how it's called, like sequence ID across.
I just have a couple questions.
Yeah.
I think we all.
I think it's time for questions. Yeah, because like said, because I have one, two.
I'm more interested in knowing how quorum works. So when you've got a cluster and maybe a node falls out of the cluster, how does it resync?
Yeah. So the question was about how the quorum works. It doesn't. So we don't have like a traditional quorum thing. We use a quorum, but for a different thing. I will explain it in a moment. So in Hazelcast, I like to say that because sort of the idea of Hazelcast was born in the minds of the free minds in the free country. They don't want to talk about like master slave. So in this case, all members are peers. And they more like think about this like oldest member, appreciation for oldest member. So oldest member does a little bit more. You can imagine this like for example today when we came into this this room, there were some guys that you know meet you there. So this is one member of the cluster was there first. He knows you know a little bit more. So when new people starting arriving, they will just go to this guy. He introduces him to the crowd, and after that, they, you know, is precisely what we're doing right now, forming the cluster. So, so in this case, the oldest member of the cluster accept connection for this new node, introduces the topology of the cluster, and after that, they start, you know, the migration of the process. You can ask me, Victor, what's going to happen if this oldest member going to die? So nothing bad is going to happen. So what's happened when you go to the party and the host is leaving? You was there after him, so you also know everyone here, and you can meet other people. So he just, you know, okay, so I'm tired. I'm just leaving from this party. And there was another person who was after him. So this is basically how our the leader election works. There's still another one person. Like if it like if
from the distribution after a while you kind of start losing data.
No. So
like because if you've written an application, right, and it's trying to talk to something, how do you know that he knows enough of his peers to say that he's a definitive source?
How are you preventing split brain? Yeah.
So this is nothing to do with split brain. I'll explain. So the clients and members, they exactly know where data is because they have this the partitioning mapping, how the partition map to particular node. So they know this because the oldest member, there's always one member. So if you have no members, you don't have a cluster. If you have one member, you still have some data. Probably if you lose the members in the cascading fashion and the migration not gonna finish, you probably lose data. But if one member left, migration will happen, data will reshuffle, so now we're still in good shape. We're not losing the data. And again, there is other ways to prevent losing data. Increase number of backups, configure partition groups, configure replication of the cluster. Cluster can be replicated across across WAN.
I have a warning. Say there's 100 members in the cluster now,
uh-huh,
and one more member joins. Mm-hmm. How much rebalancing happens when that one more member joins after there's 100 already?
Well, it depends. You know, it's some. It will take some time. It not take like a minutes. It maybe take some fraction of seconds. Depends on network. Depends on the size of partition. Because so what we're trying to say that we wanna, when we're talking people about like a planning of this, we wanna keep partitions small enough so it can be very fast, you know, move over the network, say up to not more than 100 megabytes or something like that. And we also not recommend to the build a cluster across the unreliable network. So you want to build a cluster within network that you have a control and have a low latency. In this case, your migration going to happen faster, you'll get the better throughput and other nice things. So for yep.
Okay, then what about a heterogeneous cluster where there's two places and maybe a wide area link across them?
Yeah, like I said, we support replication across that kind of clusters.
Okay.
We can do the active, passive. So one cluster can be all up and just back data to another cluster. On both clusters can be up and continue to receive the reads. They might be happening the conflicts, and we're providing API and some of the basic resolution conflicts. We're not providing very sophisticated logic to identify what's happened. Maybe some time step. I don't know. We have internal clock cluster. So when they send the heartbeats, the information about the clock is also syncing between nodes.
Balancing algorithm is aware that it's more likely that you lose all of them on one side or all on the other side, or that the link between them is less reliable than the link inside of each side.
Yeah, this is pretty much you asking more about actual split brain. So in split brain, you're not losing nodes, you're losing the connection. And with the split brain situation, you're basically network partitioning, splitting your cluster into two different clusters. And there might be some of the clients, they're still connected to the one cluster and continue to write this one, and some clients that connect to another one. And in this case, we also have the way how we can resolve this split brain situation. We also have certain merge policies. You can, if you need more sophisticated logic, there's an interface how we can plug this in. We have very good piece of article in our documentation about how exactly the split brain, how we threading this one, how we fixing this split brain syndrome. This is kind of things that you can do. Number of backups, increase the number of backups, partition groups, the replication of the clusters. Yeah.
So, what about rolling upgrades? So, I've got one version of Hazelcast, and I have to go upgrade.
Mm-hmm.
How do I do that?
We don't have this thing out of the box yet. So in 3.6, it was very long ride to do this. So we finally have this, we call it Open Client Protocol, but I think this name sucks because, we need to have a cool name. InfiniSpan have the name of Hot Rod. It's a good name for the protocol. So we need to come up with something like this. So what it does, it's actually well-defined behavior of the clients. So starting from 3.6, you can independently update the cluster members from the client members. So potentially with 3.7, you can still use 3.6 clients. You cannot do this prior 3.6. In terms of rolling updates, we're going to introduce it at some point. We just, this Monday, we released 3.6. Oh, maybe it's something wrong with 3.6. Yay. Blame early release. In 3.7, we're going to have the roll updates. But it will involve...
So just so I'm clear, you have to take your whole application down?
Not necessarily whole application down. You can do it manually. You can bring down one node, update the software, bring it back. You can use the network. You can isolate this sure. part from rest of the cluster if you don't want them... do migration, and after that, when the
I'm not criticizing. I'm just,
I'm just explaining what's kind of stuff we So we have this the document called Operations Guide. It's on our website. If you go to hazelcast.com and the search for Operations Guide, this is exactly how we recommend to do it right now. But multiple things need to be involved. It's maybe involve some nasty stuff like a distributed class loader when you need to change the classes of certain things on the runtime. We're not doing this for one simple reason, not because we cannot, we can't do this, we don't want this, because we know that this kind of thing would be not only used, but also abused. And for, you know, you can ask us about, like, hey, we want to have this, like, hot update of Hazelcast, but you're never going to use it in the production, because your boss going to kill you if you do, like, this kind of crazy stuff, unless you boss of yourself. And the people just want to have it. And if you, for example, remember, there was a nice product called LifeRable from the Zero Turnaround. This actually does, like, remote redeployment. The guy that shut it down because no one actually doing this in production. It was a cool project. It was a cool piece of technology, but that's crazy stuff to do. And yes, it's going to be there. It's going to be part of the product. Right now, we have certain recommendations how to upgrade these clusters. Yes, I'm all for questions. I guess I don't have slides anymore. I believe so. Yeah. Because I already lost a bunch of slides. Yeah, this is. I feel you don't have this impression today. Sometimes it's like, this is how my day looks like. So thank you very much. There's this link for slides. And remember that you can have this, the nice code samples here. Like I said, I have my Twitter, the very beginning, I guess, somewhere where I lifting some stuff. Yeah, if you have some questions, just tweet me. I'll take some questions because I have a bunch of t-shirts. I definitely give you t-shirt. What size?
Large,
extra large. I have one extra large.
Extra large always fits.
Yay, cool. It's cool one. I have the t-shirt. This gentleman. So I have a large. Orange. Yeah, this is large. Yeah, I can give you like small. You can get like for a kid, and
we've got 22 numbers. I've randomly assigned numbers.
We can do that. Come on, this is random.org.
I'll write one. Just tell me what number I am. Yay.
Turns four.
20 what?
22?
I think he's got it.
All right. We actually started our.
This is random.org.
Ontario Lottery. Okay. So it was
Make it so I win the $60 million.
Okay, guys.
They actually do the drawing ahead of time. They told us.
Okay, so moment of the 1 to 22, right? All right. I'll do generate. Number two.
Oh, that's
two.
Fixed.
Who's the most random number?
Sure. Bill Gang.
Hey.
Yeah. All
right.
Yay. All right.
Thanks.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm still curious why this shit doesn't work. You see, when I show you like some open source pieces, they work great. The enterprise. Yeah, but actually, there's a couple things. Yeah, the couple things that are very interesting in terms of the enterprise piece is that we also have not only on heap the storage. We also have off heap storage. At some point, we also support this like scaling up, so we can really have the big machines to do. Let me actually show you real quick. Or you can have like really small machines. If you will Google Hazelcast logo cluster, oh sorry, Lego and not Lego, Lego cluster. And I'll do images. And this is guy, named Fuad. He's one of the co-founders. And so we actually build this the cluster of Raspberry Pis, and this is our like a server racks. And it actually was kind of fun when, you know, when you're standing on the booth on the Java one and the people come in and just, you know, randomly unplug some of the wires just to see if it breaks. This guy works really well. And the cluster of like hundreds of nodes of Raspberry Pi, it was kind of impressive to show how they, we did like, this kind of two different data centers, and we actually do like replication of these two clusters. And we have like a management center that can show you all these processes that happens in the cluster. It's kind of very nice. It's pretty cool stuff. What I'm trying to say with this picture, it can be run on the commodity hardware easily, or it can be run on really big machines. In our lab, we have, I guess, 8 machines with 0.5 terabyte of RAM. So this year on Java 1, we actually show how we can defeat like 3.5 terabytes of data in this cluster using our off-heap solution. Yeah, this is kind of, this is what we do. Sorry for demo, yeah, that was really awesome. Never happened with me before. I still have 3 t-shirts, and so I'll take some questions. Maybe not related to Hazelcast, if you want. Yes, let's start with you. Yeah, it's a good question. So, they're awesome. They just decide, okay, so let's do open source like Hazelcast do, and open source our like core piece, and we still have the enterprise piece. In terms of features, very much similar in terms of some of the stuff. Obviously, Geode and the inherit some of the Gemfire popularity, and we compare with them. So we have a benchmark on our website.
And which one is the best?
So yeah, for people who likes blood and stuff, want to see like a mud fight, etc. We have this the resources page, and they have a special type of benchmark. We have this guy, Gemfire 8.2 rudder gun. By the way, this rudder gun thing that we use, it's written by InfiniSpan guys. So this is actually like tool that testing distributed grids. Our own testing, we develop our tool. We call it Hazelcast Simulator. The grid game guys, they develop their tool called the Yardstick. And we're using like tools that other vendors provide to beat them. Yeah, and we were sharing the sources and stuff. So, yeah, you can go and try. Even Coherence, Oracle Coherence, yay.
There's a lot of pivotal people here today, so I'd watch out, you know.
Well, I'm a big guy, you know. I can handle a couple. Yeah. Yeah. Yes, it's called, it's okay. We still can be friends. Yeah.
Is it a pure key value, or is there like a strategy for relational? I see a tab.
Personally, I consider it like harmful to do like distributed joins. Some people actually the proud of this feature in their product. I think it's like breaking people's mind because, you know, we try to get people from the dark ages of relational databases and, you know, make them think in objects again. So when people bank in object, now you need to translate it to relations to put it in database. Now we start, you know, veining this and bringing people to the light, but they still want to have the distributed.
So the answer for Hazelcast.
1 second, I'll answer this. So we have the ability to do you know, that kind of stuff because we have MapReduce, we have aggregations, but unfortunately for me, we also have plans to introduce distributed joins. So right now it's not there. You need to you need to come up with your own model how this you can design this relationship. Like I said, one of the ways how to do this is to use like partition aware keys, and you know, related data can be mapped on the same partition. So in this case, you sort of like when you do map.get for company, you can get your associates, and they will be on the same, but we're not doing this out of the box. So we're not doing like joins when we need to query. We have the query engine that allows you write the predicates to read the data from this map, not only key value. but we not support joins in queries. What size? Or you guys don't want to have a Hazelcast short and pivotal? So what I do have here, I have a 2 medium and 1 large. Who wants large? You want large? Okay, sorry about that. And 1 medium. I have a last t-shirt, medium, taking questions.
Oh, yeah. So you were talking about how the partitions, that you keep the partitions across like you know, most of the nodes. When does this occur? Is there a background process that's kind of constantly sharing data between nodes, or
yeah.
Does it happen?
Yeah, it happens as a part of the heartbeat the kind of information, heartbeat procedure that the old node sends all day. The oldest member of the cluster is responsible for, you know, updating this data for everyone. So they listen this, and if topology of cluster change, it's easy to detect, right? Because each and every member, they have connection to each other, and you know, when something breaks connection, you can, you know, figure out really quickly. And all this member need to, you know, initiate the process of migration, and after that have this updated. To do what?
So behind the scenes, the nodes are exchanging data. One node might be the one that initially got, you know, a bunch of data, and now it wants to start sharing it amongst the other nodes. Is there any configuration for, like, you know, how much bandwidth you would use to have each node share data amongst themselves that isn't?
This kind of thing we're trying to not expose to end users. We like to, you know, keep it ourselves. However, if you do like a replication of the clusters, like WAN replication, as we said, you have this ability to control this. You have ability to control batch size, you have ability to control number of messages, delay, and stuff like that. But not in core thing. You can do it on the replication thing that does replication of the cluster, but not within the cluster. Because, you know, we don't want people rely on this kind of thing, because we might change it on the next release, and they just want to have like same behavior. They know that the data will be finally migrated, and the cluster eventually will return to the shape.
Right.
Yeah. I didn't hear a question about CAP. Usually people asking, hey, what about CAP? The cap?
Cap? A or B.
The best effort. So with CAP, we actually providing different APIs for different, or say like, we have different APIs that serve different the purpose. So for example, if you want to have like more or less strong consistency, you need to use like a synchronous API. You can use like a put and synchronous backups. If you have like less consistent behavior, you can do like a synchronous API. In case of partition, you know, if cluster one of the member goes down, we also prevent consistency over availability. So we actually block some of the writes that happens on the cluster while we're migrating the data. However, reads still available. So we're actually dropping some of the availability at this point. We have like partition data structure, or we have replicated data structure, and they have less consistent behavior for obvious reason. Because the replication happens asynchronously, the replicated map is eventually consistent. Things like that.
So out of the box, what do you get?
So out of the box, we're not judging ourselves by just this theorem, because I read this. It's actually a very good article. But like this is actually the harmful thing to consider the system from just from perspective of this year, because it's not enough to say you know, it's just the consistency CP or AP over, you know, you just cannot have like this. It's too simple to judge a particular system according to the theorem. There's not enough things in this theorem to describe this kind of stuff. So this is why you know, usually people asking this, and I saying that I don't want to like debate on this one. It's like too theoretical thing. This is what we do, how we're doing this, and here's like strong consistency guarantee, less strong consistency guarantee, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, sorry for demo once again. Thanks, guys. If you have some questions, send me them. We're gonna hang out sometime here, so you can ask something. Thank you very much. You were very, you know, I never spoke in that kind of crowd. It's actually pretty cool. Like I can feel myself as like stand-up comedian or something like that. So sorry for like bad jokes.